I have found that people practicing meditation often say, I am very close to Nirvana. I will be getting Nirvana in a short time. I am very much on the brink. They think that Nirvana is something they get or they are going to reach. And they are eagerly watching themselves to see whether Nirvana is around the corner. This problem is particularly severe with Westerners because Nirvana, they think, is a particular thing which can be verified and possessed. Indians, since they are familiar with Indian languages, may know what Nirvana means. Vana is movement, fast movement. Vana is actually Pali. The Sanskrit equivalent is Bana. Bana is arrow, arrow of time. Nir means without. So Nirvana means without movement. Any expectation is a movement of the mind. Any evaluation is a mental movement. So long as you are eagerly awaiting something, that itself prevents the opening out of the mind. Nirvana truly is disappearance of the mind itself. So therefore, Nirvana is something which can never be verified. If somebody says, I have got Nirvana or I have experienced Nirvana, it means that he has not even understood what it is. So when you don't care at all, absolutely, you don't want to reach anywhere, you don't want to get anything, you don't want to possess anything, that is called Nirvana. So any self-conscious assertion of having reached somewhere is contrary to the very idea of Nirvana. Now, some people ask, is Nirvana contentment? No, it is not. Contentment is satisfaction with existing conditions. So you have a government job, you have a good family, you have a comfortable income, you are secure, you have a good insurance, you have a bank balance, so you are contented. Is this Nirvana? No. Nirvana is not the result of anything, rather it is in spite of anything and everything. So contentment is satisfaction with whatever you are attached to. While true Nirvana is absolute detachment. Detachment is to specific things or specific conditions. Transcendence is absolute and general. It is unconditional. So Nirvana is stability, but that is not the stability which is reached by any particular condition. It is unconditional stability. So, Nirvana or enlightenment is not a particular state, mode, condition, experience or transformation. It is what is called a holy grail. Holy grail is a new word I coined. Holy grail is a combination of two words, holistic and integrative. Holistic in theory and integrative in practice. So the opposite of holy grail is particularization or particularity. So the final condition of holy grail is the opposite of a particular state or condition which can be verified and confirmed. It is indeterminateness. It is without boundaries. It is the absence of mind itself, and therefore there is no way of a person verifying and confirming it. So when you really don't care whether you are enlightened or not, whether you are in nirvana or not, you are truly enlightened, you are truly in nirvana. Now there is a great deal of interest in these things in psychology. There is a new branch of psychology called the psychology of consciousness. All people working in the field of psychology of consciousness are not necessarily psychologists. There are many people from other disciplines like neurology interested in this. For example, there are people like Charles T. Tart and Robert Ornstein who have done considerable research in this area and also have written books. The field is also known by other names like altered states of consciousness and transpersonal psychology. Many of these experts are coming to India to study those who practice meditation. They travel all over Himalayas trying to study those who are practicing all kinds of spiritual practices. The investigations include physiological studies, changes in brain waves of those who practice meditation, and general physical changes, and all that. I have attempted to develop a system called holigrative psychology, which combines personality measurement and personality change, and relating these to spirituality and spiritual practices. The main problem I have found in India is that when the Aryans came, the original Aryans were Kshatriyas. They were very aggressive people, and they put a lot of aggressiveness into these practices. What was natural and spontaneous for the Indus Valley people became highly effortful and egoistic endeavor for the Kshatriyas. Most of the original leaders in the Jain religion, which emerged from the Kshatriya clan, were kings. They introduced the idea that you have to struggle to get enlightened. And I shall tell you how Jainism started. There was a king by name Rishabhadeva. He is also called Adinath. He was a king. And one day he was watching the dance performance of a beautiful girl by name Neelanjana. Neelanjana was dancing, and the king was enjoying the dance. So in the middle of the dance, Neelanjana assumed a certain posture, but she didn't move from that posture, and the king asked some people to check why she is not moving. And then they went and checked and found that the girl was dead. So the king, Rishabhadeva, was horrified. A beautiful girl could not even complete her dance, and she died in the middle of the dance. So he suddenly realized that everything is transitory. So he would have seen these Indus Valley older people wandering here and there happily without any care. So he thought there must be a way to get out of suffering, to find out the truth of our existence. So he renounced everything, his kingdom, his kingship, and went to the forest, and it is said that he stood on one leg till he got enlightened. Now what a torturous method. So finally he got enlightenment and he became the first Jain Tirthankar. So a long line of Tirthankaras followed and thus evolved the Jain religion with its extreme practices. And this set the tone of spiritual practices in modern later India.